Od četvrte sezone emisije Na rubu znanosti godinu završavamo emisijom pod naslovom Čudno. Tako i ovu, 12. sezonu, čeka ista sudbina. Vrijeme je za malu zbirku nekih čudnih priča koje su se u proteklih 9 mjeseci mogli vidjeti u emisiji. Sve se one više ili manje nalaze izvan iskustva ili konsenzusa koje nazivamo znanjem. Što ne znači da su manje stvarne. I zato ćemo i ovu sezonu zapečatiti izborom nekih od najčudnijih priča iz protekle sezone. Jer sve što ćete vidjeti jednoga dana će možda biti potpuno normalno. Ali za sada još uvijek čudno. Svjetlosne kugle, materializacija predmeta, parapsihološke fotografije i videosnimke, dvosmjerna komunikacija s onostranim bićima i njihovo vizualno ukazanje, sve je to dio fenomena koji su zabilježeni tijekom petogodišnjih pokusa u britanskom selu Skoll. Fenomenima su svjedočili mnogi znanstvenici i istraživači, a Robin Foy, sudionik pokusa u Skollu, ispričao nam iz prve ruke sve što se događalo na tim spiritističkim seansama. Riječ koja svakako pada na pamet jest čudno.
Svjetlosne kugle, materializacija predmeta, dvosmjena komunikacija s onostranim bićima i njihovo vizualno prikazivanje, fenomeni su to koji su se navodno pojavljivali tijekom spiritističkih seansi u britanskom selu Skollu, na granici okruga Norfolk i Suffolk. Britanac Robin Foy, dugogodišnji istraživač spiritizma, sudjelovao je u tim događajima od prvog dana. Autor je knjige Svjedočenje nemogućem, u kojoj iscrpno opisuje fenomene kojima je prisustvovao. Potkraj 1992. sa svojim suprugom Sandrom osnovao je društvo Noine Arke. Taj spiritistički krug istraživača surađivao je s parapsihološkim medijima, Dianom i Alenom Bennettom, koji su tijekom seansi padali u trans. Tada su navodno komunicirali s preminulim entitetima.
We started sitting in December 1992 and the first results that we properly got were in May 1993. We were not aware of the fact that we were actually sitting in a different way from the way people had sat in the past, which was an ectoplasm-based way. The first phenomena we got was that the trumpet fell over one week while we were sitting off the table, and then the next week it actually gently removed itself from the table, levitated, and then went very, very gradually down to the floor. We didn't get any more phenomena at all until the October of that year. And on that occasion, we actually had an apport of a coin which was called a Churchill crown. And that Churchill crown arrived during the sitting. We heard it drop onto the table quite loudly. And then through trance, we were told that this apport was a sign of greater things to come.
Sljedećih nekoliko tjedana, tvrde očevici, počeli su se događati čudesne stvari. Glasovi entiteta, koji su u početku govorili kroz medije, poslije su se čuli odasvud iz prostorije. Predstavili su se kao skupina duhova. Naglasili su da će rabiti pseudonime umjesto pravih imena. Istraživači su poslije bili uvjereni da su tu skupinu činili preminuli znanstvenici, poput britanskog pionira u razvoju elektronskih cijevi, Williama Crookesa, te britanskog fizičara Olivera Josepha Lodgea, pionira bežične telegrafije.
We had some work done with psychic photography and camera, which had been placed on a chair, had actually levitated and started taking pictures by itself and winding itself on. We started to work with Polaroid films, which we never put in the camera at all. And then finally, we were told, we want you to actually leave them in the sealed carton. They've come from the shopping. We started to get the most amazing stuff on there, all sorts of pictures of different places in the spirit world, pictures of stars, pictures of areas in the spirit world they described as areas of communication, where there appeared to be clouds on the picture, but the clouds turned into faces.
Jednom prigodom materializirane su i novine s datumom od travnja 1944. godine. Analiza je pokazala da potječu iz tog doba. No očevici tih nesvakidašnjih događaja nisu to zadržali samo za sebe. Seansama su prisustvovali mnogi znanstvenici, istraživači paranormalnog izvan njihova kruga. Nadzirali su pokuse kako bi bili sigurni da nije riječ o prijevari. Tijekom pokusa u školu snimljeno je više od 1000 sati razgovora s entitetima. Istraživači su putem parapsiholoških fotografija dobili upute da izgrade uređaj, navodno je omogućavao dvosmjernu komunikaciju.
The very first person to speak through it properly was Thomas Edison himself, and he spoke to us for about 15 minutes, of which actually all of these things were recorded at the time, and those recordings still exist, although they've never been made public. But, you know, we eventually were literally speaking to other beings from other worlds, as well as the spirit team, through this device.
U pokusima je sudjelovao i poznati biolog Rupert Sheldrake. Poslije je izjavio da je tijekom seanse vidio materializaciju ruke koja mu je dotaknula rame.
But yes, Rupert Sheldrake saw a spirit hand. Many, many, many people who sat with us, hundreds, had the same experience, but not just a spirit hand. Many were able to actually see in the spirit lights that were brought on occasions, the materialized spirit being sitting with us. The materialized personalities, sometimes totally solid to us, were teleported from the spirit world into our sessions through a portal which had been made by the spirit team.
Skupina duhova predložila istraživačima da izvedu novi pokus. Kamera je snimala ogledalo u mračnoj prostoriji u kojoj su se održavale seanse. Taj projekt nazvan je Alisa.
And bearing in mind that this was all being done in total darkness, we got the most remarkable pictures occurring on our video camera, which were totally animated. So that in the end, there was a team in our future. They were basically just an experimental team that were investigating, but they lived actually in our future. And they were somehow connecting with us. They were using what was known, and we were told about it by the spirit people, a crystal probe, which unfortunately every time we sat, they were able to connect into our work. And out of this came a most awful sort of hideous whining noise that stopped the mediums being in trance. And eventually the spirit team weren't able to put it right, and of course that's why the whole thing was closed down. But it was five wonderful years.
Godine 1999. Društvo za parapsihološka istraživanja objavilo je u svojem glasilu detaljan izvještaj o petogodišnjim pokusima.
Three scientists that sat with us made a wonderful job of that report and came out with a conclusion that everything they witnessed was 100% genuine. But they actually put out a challenge for anybody that felt that what happened at Skoll was not genuine to repeat it under identical conditions. Nobody, but nobody, has ever actually attempted to...
Kad bi se starost našeg planeta prikazala kao jedan dan, postojanje čovjeka na njemu bilo bi tek djelić sekunde. Kad bi se starost ljudske vrste i homo sapiensa prikazala kao jedan dan, naša bi civilizacija bila tek djelić sekunde. To je razdoblje koje obuhvaća naše sjećanje. Niti to baš pouzdano, ali što onda sa svim onim vremenom prije? Je li bilo povijesti i prije povijesti? Drugim riječima, je li suvremena civilizacija koja ima kontinuitet od tek 5500 godina prva koja je procvjetala na Zemlji? Slabi izgledi nikad nisu bili prepreka ljudskoj znatiželji. Nju je probudila i zemlja Mu, mitski potonuli pacifički kontinent koji je kroz mitove i egzotične izvore počeo izvirati krajem 19. stoljeća. James Churchward, autor najslavnijih knjiga o zemlji Mu i zapravo onih koje su tu temu postavili na pozornicu, davno je preminuo. Ali njegov praunuk živ je i zdrav je i znatiželjan po pitanju istraživanja svog pradjeda. A istovremeno krenuti tragom mitske zemlje Mu i tragom vlastitog pradjeda sigurno mora biti vrlo čudno.
Arheolog amater James Churchward napisao je 5 knjiga o mitskoj zemlji Mu u Tihom oceanu. Podatke o toj temi navodno je prikupljao više od 50 godina. Tragom ovih tvrdnji krenuo je Jack Churchward, Jamesov praunuk, koji danas živi u Clearwateru u Floridi. Autor je knjige Micanje vela s izgubljenog kontinenta Mu, kolijevke čovječanstva. U knjizi analizira radove i utemeljenost navoda svoga pradjeda.
I'm the great grandson of James Churchward, and in the late 1920s, my great-grandfather started writing a series of books on the lost continent of Mu. His first book was The Lost Continent of Mu, Motherland of Men, followed up by The Children of Mu, and he made some modifications to The Lost Continent of Mu and just kept it at that. Later, he wrote The Sacred Symbols of Mu and The Cosmic Forces of Mu in two volumes.
Jacka u početku nije zanimala istraživačka ostavština njegovog pradjeda. U obitelji Churchwardovih smatralo se da je James bio šarlatan. Pojavom interneta sve se promijenilo. Jacka su mnogi počeli pitati za mišljenje o knjigama njegovog pradjeda, pa je počeo s intenzivnim istraživanjem.
Essentially, his theory was that he had conducted research since his time in India in the late 1860s, and he had discovered or actually been shown some tablets by a rishi at a temple that he had been assisting in famine relief, he wrote. And the results of translating the tablets with the rishi was that he had discovered news and information about an amazing civilization that was thousands and thousands of years old and embodied the creation of man, as opposed to the Levant being the cradle of humankind or Africa. His theories, and the tablet showed him the background information on these theories, that man originated on a lost Pacific Ocean continent.
Jack Churchward nastoji objektivno analizirati radove svoga pradjeda. Primjerice, u mnogim referencijama spominje se kako je James Churchward imao čin pukovnika britanske vojske. Analizirajući mnogobrojnu arhivu i dopisujući se s britanskim arhivom, Jack je zaključio da dokazi ipak upućuju da James nije imao taj čin. Možda je tako svojim čitateljima knjige htio prikazati vjerodostojnijima. Međutim, Jack nije uvjeren da zbog toga odmah treba odbaciti sve tvrdnje njegovog pradjeda. Primjerice, svi citati i referencije koje je rabio pokazali su se točnima.
He spoke about the advanced civilization that the individuals of Mu enjoyed. They had roofless temples so they could absorb the rays of the sun. They were great navigators. They had Vimana, according to what my great-grandfather wrote, that they could fly around. My grandfather wrote that the people of Mu had a greater civilization or higher level of technology and civilization than he experienced in the 1920s. And I guess he's referring back to being born in the old stone house in England when in 1850, where probably it was amazing to him to see all the technological advances that they had, but he believed that the people of Mu had an even greater technology. His technology that the people of Mu had wasn't actually as hard as ours are, or as hard as our technology is, as far as having little devices and gadgets to help life along. I'm not sure that they had all those. His thought was that their technology derived from their untapped they tapped into their mental abilities.
Točnu lokaciju indijskog hrama i kamenih ploča koje govore o civilizaciji Mu, James nikada nije otkrio u svojim knjigama. Navodno je tako htio zaštititi anonimnost svećenika i artefakte koje su mu pokazali u povjerenju.
In 1911, William Niven, who had already obtained the archaeological bug and had been going through quite a few places in Guerrero State in Mexico. He also was a mineralogist and mined for gold. But in 1911, he took up his home base in Mexico City and started to excavate in the Valley of Mexico. And around about 1921, he started discovering a myriad, a plethora of these stone tablets made of different symbols and whatnot. He actually found 2,600 of them, and each of these tablets were photographed and etched, and he made rubbings of each of them and made sure that he documented what, where they were found and what distance from the surface they were discovered.
Kada je James Churchward čuo za Nivenova otkrića tablica u Meksiku, počeo se s njim dopisivati. Smatrao je da postoji veza između tih tablica i kamenih ploča koje je vidio u Indiji. Nivenove tablice navodno su se poslije izgubile tijekom jednog transporta iz Meksika u Sjedinjene Države. Dokazi su opet neuhvatljivi. James Churchward tvrdio je da je kontinent zemlje Mu potonuo zbog kataklizme.
Well, my great grandfather wrote that Atlantis was one of the stopover sites at from Mu. It was a colony of Mu. There was a greater colony in the Asian continent called the Uyghur Empire, but the people that headed eastward to Europe and colonized Europe and Egypt stopped over in Atlantis. And I have heard that there were theories by other individuals that there was some nuclear war between Atlantis and Lemuria, but actually what happened, according to my great-grandfather's theory, is that the Archean gas belts that collapsed and allowed the sinking of Mu, it was the same that happened to Atlantis, that the Archean gas belts that ran through the under the crust of the earth had filled up with lava. Eventually the volcanoes exploded and the gas belts collapsed and the continent sunk. I believe that if Mu did exist, and perhaps it wasn't as big as my great-grandfather had shown in his maps covering the entire Pacific Ocean. For instance, some people point to the Yonaguni monument off of Okinawa in Japan as part of what could have been at one time Mu. Perhaps if there was Mu, maybe it was down there, as and the remnants are underwater, but some of the remnants might be above water as well.
Konoplja je jedna od prvih biljaka na svijetu koje je čovjek počeo koristiti i za neke druge svrhe osim prehrane. U Kini prije najmanje 10.000 godina, a u Europi prije 5.500 godina. To su bile naznake potencijala koje se danas ponovno otkriva. Iskoristivost konoplje nadmašuje sva očekivanja. Proizvodi načinjeni od konoplje višestruko su jeftiniji, a proizvodnja i korištenje konoplje ima višestruki pozitivni utjecaj na okoliš. Njen dugački i jaki korijen može prodreti i do 150 cm u dubinu, pa rahli tvrda nabijena tla za druge usjeve, ili se pak zbog gustog lišća i visine koristi na stepama kojima prijeti pretvaranje u pustinje. Konoplja raste brzo, otporna je na biljne bolesti, zahtjeva malo zalijevanja, uspijeva u većini klima i obogaćuje tlo. Osim kao hranu i sirovinu za tkanine i papir, danas je jasno da se može koristiti i kao građevinski materijal, pa za razne plastične mase, gorivo, sve što je neophodno suvremenom svijetu koje nekako zaboravio na konoplju, što je već samo po sebi dosta čudno.
Zahvaljujući viziji nekoliko entuzijasta iz Slovenije, na tržištu u susjedne države danas su dostupni mnogi proizvodi od industrijske konoplje. Sve je počelo 2009. kada se pojavila zamisao o izradi tekstilnih proizvoda za djecu. Tako je nastala tvrtka Baby Natura.
Začeli smo iz osebne iskušnje, ker je naš sin imel težave za kožo. Tako da smo z možem sva iskala dobavitelja 3 mesece nekje preko interneta in iskala sva dejansko, kaj je danes še najbolj naravnega. In prišla sva samo do industrijske konoplje. Tako smo začeli in rezultati so danes tukaj, da smo generalni uvozniki za Slovenijo in za Hrvaško.
Jaz sem pa tudi ugotovil, da si želim delati nekaj, kar bi bilo dejansko dobro za kompletno skupnost, ker mi te konvencionalne gradnje mi niso niti malo pri srcu, ta cement, beton in vse to skupaj. In sem pač našel edino možno naravno gradnjo in to je dejansko gradnja iz industrijske konoplje. Tako da jaz pa že razvijam z te zidake in ta testiranja dobra 3 leta. Imam potrjene rezultate iz ZAGA, to je Zavod za gradbeništvo Slovenije, kjer sem dobil zelo dober rezultat za termalno vrednost. Iz tehnične fakultete imam tudi za tlačno trdnost dober rezultat. Skratka, prednosti te gradnje so pa sledeče. Zelo dobra termalna vrednost, zvočna izolativnost, zrakotesnost, mikroklimo ima čudovito, uravnava vlago in zrak in toploto.
In sem začel razmišljati, pač, kako bi nekaj dejansko iz tega potem naredil in sem se odločil, da bom naredil dizajn hiše, katera lahko sama sebe vzdržuje. Se pravi, da proizvaja svojo elektriko, da proizvaja svojo vodo oziroma prečiščuje deževnico in da je pa cela narejena iz konoplje. To se pravi od sten do pohištva, do tal, do dejansko stekel, ki so narejene iz dejansko PVC-ja, plastike, tako kot pleksi steklo, katero je narejeno iz nafte, je lahko prav tako narejeno iz konopljine plastike. In ta plastika lahko učrpava od sonca energijo, jo zadrži in to lahko prevedemo v električno energijo.
Uvažamo pa tudi blago, iz metrsko blago iz industrijske konoplje. Vso blago in izdelke smo dali testirati na Inštitut za tekstilstvo v Ljubljano, kjer nam je dr. Tatjana Rijavec naredila raziskavo in stvar oziroma vsi izdelki ustrezajo kvaliteti in so primerni predvsem za alergike, za otroke in za ljudi nasploh, ki se ogromno potijo.
Sedaj dobivam, ne vem, konopljino hrano dobivam iz Romunije, ker v Romuniji sedaj, rečemo, že 50 let ni bila zemlja nič gnojena, nič se ni obdelvali in so bili dejansko pašniki tam. Zdaj so pa tam naredili res veliko pač tovarno, v bistvu predelovalnico konoplje in pač skupaj v sodelovanju pač mi oni dajajo produkte, jaz jih imam pa pač kot svoje za naprej za prodajo. Enako sem naredil za konopljino kozmetko, katera je narejena v Sloveniji, samo poreklo konoplje pa prihaja iz Francije, tako da je tudi kozmetika bi se lahko rekel na nivoju. No. Imam pa seveda tudi oblačila, lejte, kot vidite, sem ves napravljen v oblačila, katere sem dejansko sam naredil. Se pravi, blago je iz Romunije, slovenske šivilje so mi pa se šile po mojih željah. Ne. Zato lahko vidite, da je res moje hlače, čevli, srajca, vse. Tako da se z industrijske konoplje res da narediti od A do Ž.
Ker sem si jaz želel narediti prvi objekt iz industrijske konoplje v Sloveniji, sem dobil eno možnost v Biopark Žalcu, kjer je ta gospod direktor je bil pač navdušen, da bi mu naredil oziroma da bi zgradili piramido iz industrijske konoplje.
Naredil sem rečemo tudi etanol, katerega sem pa dal v starega jugoslovanskega Tomosa, zmešal z konopljenim oljem in sedaj laufa in ker tok diši za mano, dejansko vsi vaški psi laufajo za mano. Ne zaradi tega, ker bi jim smrdela, ampak ker jim diši. Se pravi, ne onesnažujem okolje, niti s tem, ker se okrog vozim. Ne.
Piramida je dimenzije 5,5x5,5, je usmerjena sever, jug, vzhod, zahod. Vhod je seveda na vzhodni strani, tako kot mora biti. In ravno na eni tretjini bo največja energija, kjer bo človek stal. Tako da, se pravim, to je čudovito. V njej se bo pa dogajalo, seveda, v njej bojo pa razna predavanja, meditacije, masaže, pogovori in seanse. Ne?
Wise World sem jaz naredil v bistvu začetku leta 2012. Začel sem raziskovati vse, kar se da narediti iz konoplje. In sem šel na pot okrog celega sveta. Sem najdel pač najbolj primerno mesto, kjer registrirati podjetje in to sem najdel pač Hong Kong. Zato, ker imam od tam, od Hong Konga, odprte vse vezi sveta. Se pravi, imam direktno kitajski trg, imam lahko uvažen v evropski trg in posod. In zato sem se potem tudi dogovoril, da sem vse te dejansko, kateri se ukvarjajo s konopljo, združil pod eno okrilje.
Glede na to, da je dejansko z industrijsko konopljo lahko pokrijemo vse kompletne potenciale človeštva, si želim za začetek vsaj kakšno oziroma par hiš iz konoplje, kjer se bojo pa tudi prehranjevali za konopljo in bojo bili tudi oblečeni v konopljo. Za začetek je to, so moje zelo velike želje in verjamem, da tudi nismo tako daleč do realizacije.
Če bi samo koruzo zamenjali za konopljo, koruza dejansko sama po sebi za človeško telo ni prebavljiva in tudi za krmo ni ne vem kaj dobra za živali. Če bi samo to zamenjali za konopljo, bi en hektar konoplje prinesel kot prvo eno delovno mesto na hektar, se pravi to pomeni več kot milijon delovnih mest v Sloveniji, katerih trenutno nimamo. Imeli bi hrano, imeli bi tekstil, imeli bi gradben material, imeli bi svoj zelen petrol, dejansko etanol.
Tako.
Vse bi skratka lahko
naredili. Samo zadostni bi
samo
bili
zadostni
lahko,
bi bili. Tako, in neodvisni dejansko neodvisni, od Evrope ne. In od evra.
Tako.
Manje poznata dimenzija elektroterapije, poznata i kao bioelektrična medicina, svoj početak duguje doktoru Raymondu Rajfu, vlasniku niza doktorata i nagrada i zaslužnom za niz izuma koje se danas koriste u optici, elektronici, biokemiji i drugim znanostima. Rajf, a paralelno i znanstvenik Lahovski na drugom kraju svijeta, ustanovili su da svaki patogeni organizam ima svoju karakterističnu smrtnu frekvenciju i da se djelovanjem radiofrekvencijskim zrakama patogeni organizmi mogu uništiti. Ovo otkriće tek je krajem 80. godina 20. stoljeća pokrenulo relativno novu granu zvanu bioelektrična medicina, koja se koristi malim strujama sa specifičnom frekvencijom za uništenje parazita u ljudskom tijelu. Danas se na nekim mjestima i kroz rad nekih upornih pojedinaca tehnologija Raymonda Rajfa, pionira i pravog začetnika tog specifičnog vida elektroterapije, ponovno ispituje i testira. Internet omogućuje pak da svatko može pratiti tijek eksperimenata pa i porazgovarati s tim ljudima i saznati ponešto što je doista čudno.
Upoznajte Antonija Hollanda, dirigenta i doktora glazbene kulture na koleđu Skidmore u Saratoga Springsu u američkoj saveznoj državi New York. Život mu se promijenio kada je saznao za bioelektrični uređaj američkog inženjera Royala Raymonda Rajfa koji je nastao tijekom 1930-ih. Fascinirala ga je tvrdnja da je uređaj mogao odašiljanjem radiofrekvencije uništavati mikroorganizme. Tako je uspostavio kontakt s izumiteljem Jamesom Barreom, koji danas izrađuje uređaje po Rajfovim zamislima.
Dr. Barre's device is a special type of radio frequency transmitter that utilizes amplitude modulated signals. What that means is if the wave has a certain height or size, the size of that wave will be changed in time very rapidly, so we are modulating the amplitude. But he had a very unique approach to amplitude modulation. He modulates the amplitude so much, more than any radio engineer would modulate it, to the point where the signal actually shuts off briefly. And the net result is he gets a series of pulses of radio frequency. So RF pulses, and it turns out that the biological effects of caused by Dr. Barre's device seem to be very much connected to these pulses caused by this overmodulation.
Uređaj odašilje frekvenciju od 27 MHz. Unutar te frekvencije utisku se različiti niskofrekventni signali. Budući da je Antoni bio stručnjak za sintetičke tonove, s uređajem je spojio generator frekvencija kako bi mogao manipulirati s utisnutim signalima.
So if I send in 440 Hz or 440 vibrations per second, the signal of the radio frequency carrier, the 27.12 MHz carrier, will be modulated up and down 440 times a second. So this is how the operator of Dr. Barre's device has some control over it, and it turns out that the frequencies that I select to put into his transmitter very much control the final output that come out of the antenna. I should mention the antenna for this device is a very special antenna. It's a glass sphere. It's partially evacuated. And then it's backfilled or filled with a little bit of helium gas. And what happens is the pulsing radio frequencies are sent into this sphere and they cause the helium gas to light up in like a fluorescent light, really. And when helium gas is electrified, it's called a plasma. And when you have a glass ball with a plasma that is pulsing inside of it, it acts like a special type of radio transmitter.
Antoniju je trebalo 15 mjeseci intenzivnih pokusa da pronađe pravi splet frekvencija koje dovode do uništenja mikroorganizama.
And one day, to my great surprise and delight, when I added the 11th harmonic of the original frequency, the blepharisma just shattered under the microscope like a crystal glass. It was unbelievable, and later I showed it to many of my colleagues in the biology department where I'm a professor. I'm a music professor, and I went to the biology department and I said, look at this video, and they all said the same thing. We have never seen anything like that. That's incredible. the way the organism literally shatters from one end to the other and breaks up into many, many small pieces and is destroyed, basically.
Upoznajte doktora Jonathana Brodya, jednog od vodećih istraživača raka. Prije svoje medicinske karijere bio je student glazbene kulture. 19 godina poslije ponovno se sreo sa svojim starim profesorom glazbe Anthonyjem Hollandom. Anthony mu je pokazao snimke pokusa na kojima uništava mikroorganizme s Rifeovim uređajem. Brodya je to toliko zainteresiralo pa je predložio da pokušaju uništiti stanice raka u laboratoriju sveučilišta Thomas Jefferson u Filadelfiji.
And one night in the lab, Dr. Brody phoned me very, very late and he said, we did a double analysis, two separate lab experts, and he was one of them actually. He himself personally counted the cells in this leukemia experiment and the other person who counted had two doctorate, and he said, you are killing at least, on average, 25-30% of the leukemia cells using your electric fields. And he told me the next day when we got together, he said, first of all, he said, this is impossible. It's not in any of the literature. It can't be done. So I don't know how it can be. I don't know what you're doing, but it's impossible. And it's so impossible that even if you could do it again and again and again, six more times with five different types of cancer cells, and every time you killed 30%, he said, I don't know if we could publish it because nobody would believe it in my field. There's nothing like it. If you were a large pharmaceutical company and you spent millions of dollars developing a new drug to kill leukemia cells, and you found out you were killing 25-30%, it's a major home run. It's a huge victory for the pharmaceutical company, but we didn't use any drugs or any radiation. It was all done with Dr. Baer's device. I was convinced this has to get out to the world. People have to know we can kill. We've have data saying that between 30 and 60, and on top of that, we were slowing their growth rate by another 20%. So we can slow it down, we can kill a huge percentage, and those were just preliminary tests.
No, koji mehanizam uzrokuje takvo uništenje mikroorganizama? Članci iz ovoga područja tek se odnedavno objavljuju u znanstvenim časopisima. Postoji nekoliko teorija.
Our team, which includes a Professor Gerard Dubost of France, who's an expert in the effects of electromagnetic fields on biological organisms. He has many published papers, and he's also an expert in plasma. So he's been tremendously helpful in the papers we have written. And actually, his calculations show what's happening is the frequencies that we're sending into the cancer cells are actually matching the precise length of these tiny tubules. These microtubules have a certain length, and that can be measured under the microscope. And that means that if you can impose a wave that fits exactly along the length of that tiny little microtubule, and you can maintain that wave for a certain amount of time, the vibration will get larger and larger, and eventually the tube will be broken.
Dr. Brody planirao je napisati znanstveni članak o tom revolucionarnom otkriću, no brinule su ga potencijalne kritike kolega iz znanstvene zajednice. Ako bi podaci pokazali bilo kakvu grešku, bio bi to kraj njegove karijere. Neprestano je odlagao objavljivanje zahtijevajući nove pokuse. No, Anthony je uložio mjesece vlastitog vremena i novca, pa je odlučio okrenuti novi list. Osnovao je neprofitnu organizaciju Novobiotronics.
Here's a little picture of leukemia cells. And you start off with three leukemia cells, and over the course of time, two of the cells are completely shattered into tiny fragments. Now, when people start seeing that kind of thing, then they realized, yeah, this is real. This actually works, but we need help. So we started a company. I put the data up on the website, and we are appealing to the public for financial assistance. And in fact, right now, we are running an online fundraiser through a company called Indiegogo. And if you go to Indiegogo and you search under Stop the Suffering of Children. That's what we're calling our fundraiser. Help us stop the suffering of children with cancer. If we can raise about $27,000 US, we will be able to buy the key components of equipment needed to get back to our cancer research. One of our goals is that this next round of cancer research will lead to a formal publication in an official peer-reviewed cancer journal where, let's say, scientists who are a little bit more brave are willing to put their reputation on the line because they're going to see firsthand we can destroy cancer cells.
Hesdalen je dolina u središnjem dijelu Norveške, jugoistočno od Trondheima. Ta dolina, duga 12 km, bila bi mjesto kao i svako drugo da je nije obilježio jedan do današnjeg dana nerazjašnjen fenomen. Naime, u prosincu 1981. godine iznad doline pojavila su se tajanstvena svjetla, koja bi nekad mirno stajala iznad doline, nekad je doslovce preletjela velikom brzinom, a ponekad lagano mijenjala smjer, pa potom mirno stajala na mjestu. Tajanstveni svjetleći objekti uhvaćeni su i na radaru, a brzina im je bila oko 8500 metara u sekundi. Dodatnu pomutnju izazivali su njihovi oblici, koji su bili vrlo raznoliki, od oblika metka do oblika lopte ili bora. Od 1983. godine, kada je započelo znanstveno istraživanje pod nazivom Projekt Hesdalen, taj se fenomen sustavno opire bilo kakvom poznatom objašnjenju. Slijede informacije iz prve ruke od norveških istraživača, a sve vezano uz hesdalenska svjetla još uvijek najbolje odgovara riječi čudno.
Početkom 1980-ih mnogi mještani bili su očevici neobičnih svjetala u norveškoj dolini Hesdalen. Zbog čestih viđenja te zračne anomalije na posljetku su nazvane fenomenom u Hesdalenu. Uvidom u povijesne dokumente istraživači su saznali da je taj fenomen prijavljivan i ranije.
There is documentation from a priest who wrote in his diary in 1805, also during the Second World War, it was sightings. And then we ended up in the 70s and beginning of the 80s when we had this big eruption that was scientifically investigated.
There was a lot of sightings from November 1981. And at the most, we got 20 reports a week. The high activity went down in November or autumn 1984. Many people went up there to see it for themselves, and many was a success. They did see it.
Magistar elektrotehnike Erling Strand sa sveučilišta Ostfold voditelj je projekta Hesdalen, čiji je cilj da se znanstveno istraže te neobične pojave. U toj nakani pridružio mu se i njegov kolega, magistar elektrotehnike Björn Gittelhauk. Istraživačke ekspedicije pokrenute su 1984. godine. Znanstvenici i studenti snimali su svjetla u dolini s mnogim mjernim uređajima. Prikupljeni podaci na posljedku su promijenili stajališta medija koji su u početku uglavnom ismijavali očevice. Karakteristike fenomena definirane su s nekoliko kategorija.
Very short, quick flash, blue light, that just one tenth of a second, that just flashes up on the sky and vanishes again.
Another type is yellow or white balls of light. Sometimes round, sometimes a little bit different shapes. It can be very big on two occasions. On one occasion we measured 3 meters in diameter. On another we had 10 meters. And also some have claimed up to 20 meters. So it's big and it can be strong. It can move slowly around in the valley, in the mountainside, in the smaller places around in the valley. And it has been also seen that it illuminates the ground beneath it.
Te kugle s jakim intenzitetom žutog svjetla ponekad su vidljive i duže od jednog sata. U određenim situacijama stoje nepomično na nebu, nakon čega se kreću do druge pozicije, gdje onda opet nepomično stoje. Treća kategorija viđenja odnosi se na svjetla koja se istodobno pojavljuju.
It seems to be connected to something. But because when they move, all the lights move together.
Then we have small lights that are dancing all around in the sky. These four different phenomena, we don't know if they have the same origin.
Well, all these kind of lights is in the scene when it's dark outside. We have very few reports when it's daylight. On one occasion, we measured a speed of 30,000 kilometers an hour. That was the highest speed. We used a radar to track it, and by that we could measure the speed. When we do the magnetical, the Earth magnetic field, if we have instruments who can measure that, it seems that the phenomena are more likely to show up when there are high magnetic activity. On one occasion, it was very close. There was some red light moving around our feet. That was a small thing.
Godina je 1984. Tijekom istraživačke ekspedicije istraživači su usmjerili crveni laserski snop prema anomalijskim treptavim svjetlima. Tada je došlo do neobične reakcije. Frekvencija treptanja anomalijskih svjetala dvostruko se povećala.
We took the laser down again, away from it. Didn't point on to this flashing light. And then it became regular flashing again. We put the laser up again and it became double flashing. We did this testing totally 9 times. Up onto it and down. Onto it and down, totally 9 times. And this double flashing happened 8 of those 9 times. So that was also, it seems to be a response or connection with the laser beam and the flashing light.
U kolovozu 1998. postavljena je prva mjerna postaja za automatsko snimanje doline.
My student got the task to make some program for the computers who can do some analyzing. And sometimes this has been working and also captured some phenomena on video and also pictures.
Tijekom ekspedicije iz rujna 2007. istraživači su uspjeli snimiti fenomen videokamerom i fotoaparatom.
Jag har det här! Och dave!
Vad ser jag? Tada je nastala najpoznatija fotografija fenomena s ekspozicijom dugom 30 sekundi.
Almost 60 students and scientists. Suddenly a big white light turned up in the sky right in front of us. So intense, so huge, and it was moving very quickly around in the sky. And very intense episode kept on for nearly over an hour. Very famous picture was taken then.
This was an optical spectrum picture. We haven't found any emission lines or absorption lines in these lights. It seems to be a continuous spectrum. That could indicate it could be some solid object or something which is not only air. If it has been only gas which illuminated, you should expect some emission lines, but it is continuous, and that's something strange.
Björn smatra da je tada možda ipak došlo do greške u čipu fotoaparata zbog jakog intenziteta svjetla. Zato ističe i drugu mogućnost koja upućuje na prisutnost plazme.
The very mysterious thing was that the light had vanished, but the radar saw it for almost 2 hours more after it had been shot off. And this correlates with recordings done by astrophysical stations when meteorites enters into the ionosphere and burns through. These atmospheric radars can see the remnants of the plasma in the atmosphere and the ionosphere for a long time afterwards.
Znanstvenici diljem svijeta pokazuju interes prema fenomenima u Hezdalenu. Znanstvenici iz središta za radioastronomiju nedaleko od Bolonje i stručnjaci Francuske svemirske agencije sudjeluju u toj međunarodnoj suradnji.
I think when more scientists is involved in finding the solution, you maybe get the solution more fast.
We are very interested in getting answers from plasma physicists, from lightning physicists and astrophysicists about this question. But we are investigating for an fingerprint into the electromagnetic spectrum.
We know there is some kind of energy involved illuminating the ground, etc. So where does this energy come from? What is it? That's a big question.
We are chasing a very powerful energy source that is hiding somewhere out there.